So I'm here with Ollie Wilson for this episode of The Vote, and we're here to celebrate, really, aren't we? The reopening of Madeira Drive, one way, of course, but it's open to vehicle traffic, and you've been on the news a lot, Ollie, and a victory for your campaign, really.
Absolutely. My partner, Laura King, and I started the Reopen Madeira Drive campaign because we felt that it should be used by everybody. It was a great facility. It's a gem that should be available to all citizens in Brighton and Hove and visitors. And we campaigned tirelessly for 3.5 months with the support of the South Coast Mods and with Councillor Lee Wares and people like Rob Arbery on behalf of disabled people. And we've succeeded. And I'd like to say how glad I am that the Greens have seen sense and done this U-turn, changed their minds. It takes guts to change your mind, and I respect them for doing that.
Yeah, and it was a victory for common sense in a way, because it seems that everyone is pleased with the kind of the new outcome, or at least most people. Traffic one way towards Duke's Mound, you still got going to have space for space for more cyclists, plus pedestrians as well, and the businesses can get more trade as well. And it looks like the vehicle, the old Crocs rally and all the other vehicle events, looks like they're here to stay as well.
Absolutely. Yeah, I mean, what's been announced by the Greens is the proposal that we put forward to the council meeting in August. And it was pretty demoralising at the time to hit this green-red wall where every single Labour councillor, and remember, Labour introduced this Barmy idea, and every single Green councillor and half of the independents voted to keep Madeira Drive closed. And that was really dispiriting at the time, when Laura and I and the mods and so many other people had put so much time into this. We collected 11,000 votes, 11,000 signatures for our petition against 3,000 for the opposing petition. And what we were proposing was a one-way reopening of Madeira Drive to allow plenty of room for cyclists, plenty of room for pedestrians, plenty of room for exercise, but also access for motorcyclists and scooterists and cars where needed, and a situation where disabled people didn't have to ask permission to use the facilities, the toilets and so on. And so that's absolutely brilliant. But looking back on the campaign, it's been a tough campaign, but an enjoyable one, because we've managed to not just get our way, but also change minds in terms of Greens, and I suspect Labour as well, and even Friends of the Earth are now have come around to our point of view. So we actually, rather than like the Greens had done, or Labour had done, try and impose something on people in order to change their behaviours, we made the argument logically and we changed minds and we've succeeded. So that was enjoyable. And there were certainly a number of different points where we were making progress. Very early on, Labour agreed, who were in power at that point, agreed that the events could take place again, which was a great victory, because they'd been under threat, and that would have been a great shame that all of these amazing events ended. And then it was reopened from the Concord down towards the marina, which was another sort of mini victory. And then it was reopened for the Mod Weekender, which was a surprise, but I thanked the council leader, Councillor Phelan McCafferty, for that, because I thought that was a magnanimous gesture. And now we have this full reopening along the lines that we suggested. And so I think it's a great thing.
Yeah, you're right. It was kind of a last minute decision for the Mod Weekend, because I was actually down there that day speaking to the people on the gate and stuff. But they did allow the bikes through, which I thought was a good gesture, as you say. So people are listening, and that's what to be honest, that's what people want in a city, don't they? They want to see their elected representatives listening, and in this case they have, and that's always a good thing.
Absolutely. I wanted it to be an ironic campaign, one for the common good, uniting people at this time of national crisis. And what upset me, and the reason I started the campaign, was because I felt that Labour and the Greens were taking advantage of this time of national crisis to push their own ideological agenda. And they kind of doubled down on what they were doing. And that was upsetting, to find that they were behaving in such a divisive way at a time of national crisis. But now I think they've seen the error of their ways, they've done their U-turn, and I admire them for doing that. It's a great thing they've done. And now we're moving forward in a way that unites everybody. I mean, for instance, at the Mod Weekender, one of the greatest things to see was how many racing cyclists came down to Madeira Drive. Drive to look at the scooters and the wonderful old decorated Vespas and Lambrettas, and to chat to the mods, because cyclists and mods and motorcyclists, all these, this fraternity on two wheels, we should be natural friends. And what I saw happening in Brighton and Hove was that because of the polarisation of this debate and the politics and the, you know, the way in which at that point Labour councillors and Green councillors were behaving, they were dividing people in Brighton and Hove rather than uniting them. And so I'm really glad that the campaign that I started and was supported by so many people has managed to correct that.
Yeah. And what about the businesses down there then? Because I think there's one closed already. I mean, I know they've had quite a tough summer, haven't they? So how do we revive that area down there?
Because they've had a tough time.
Yeah.
And a lot of them were just planning to close for the entire winter. So I hope they reconsider now that it's going to be open to their clientele again. And that people will support Madeira Drive. All sorts of people, motorcyclists, motorists, cyclists, pedestrians, runners, will use the cafes and keep them going. I mean, I think they'd be okay. I mean, a lot of them have accrued some savings over the years, and they've had support from the government and so on. But with their clientele, their customers back again, there's no reason why they shouldn't stay open over the winter, certainly during weekends.
Yeah, exactly. I mean, how do we revive that area down there? Because we've got the Madeira Terraces, which is slowly but surely, you know, work's going to start fairly soon on that. So that whole area needs a bit of
absolutely.
TLC, doesn't it, really?
Absolutely. The terraces, sadly, have been neglected by
Successive councils
of different political colours.
All of them,
over many years. And it's a scandal the way in which it's been neglected. And what's vital now is the money that's been raised is used, more money is raised, more money is put into restoring the terraces. Because we've got to remember that they're a very green area. There's a great place for walking. It's a great place for exercise. It's something, and it's also part of our heritage. And it would be appalling if they fell into the hands of developers, or they fell down to the degree that they couldn't be repaired. And I think one of the turning points in the campaign was when Laura King, my partner, managed to get an article about the heritage side of it into Private Eye magazine, which was highlighting what Brighton Hove City Council has done over the decades and the risk now with the closure of Madeira Drive. I felt that that was a really important moment.
Yeah, exactly. And so what would you like to see down there then? What would, like, the mods, for example, South Coast mods, what do you think is lacking down there? What would draw more people to that area? Because we were both staying, you know, just off stage there. It's not as busy as what it could be. It's not the kind of the big attraction that the Madeira Drive, you know, could be, particularly over the summer.
Well, I think you need to attract businesses with competitive rents to attract more people there. And when the terraces have been restored, there may be opportunities there. You could have a market there, for instance. By the old pier, there used to be a wonderful market at weekends that would attract a lot of people with secondhand books. There may be all sorts of things that could be considered once the terraces have been restored to make that area busier. I mean, it's going to take a little bit of time to build up again, but it needs to look attractive. It's part of our seafront. It's part of our heritage. The council needs to put money into this, and businesses need to stay open and attract people down there, because it's, you know, there's a sort of interrelated nature to it, where if you have fewer people, then the businesses don't feel it's viable to stay open, and it just spirals downwards. Whereas if you have more people, you have better businesses, you attract more people, then it all starts to thrive.
Yeah, exactly. We need it to thrive down there, don't we? Because if we are going to get businesses down, attract businesses, then we just need a footfall. Because I think one reason why the Madeira Terraces went into disrepair is because not enough people used them, did they, really? And so,
absolutely,
you know, the council probably thought, well, no one's really going to notice if they go into a bit of a state of disrepair. And if that successive councils are making the same decision, then that's where you get to where we are today.
I suspect that the council forgot for a moment under Labour and under the Greens when they started just how famous Madeira Drive is in terms of its film heritage. I remember, I think it was the second demonstration that we had. We held four demonstrations for the South Coast Mods and supported by lots of other people, where we took the scooters onto Madeira Drive and demonstrated. And I think it was the second one where the Press Association sent a photographer and a reporter wrote a report about it. And it appeared in newspapers all over Britain, in places like Belfast, and all over the UK, places like Belfast and several major Scottish newspapers in Aberdeen, in Glasgow, and local newspapers all over Britain were writing about Madeira Drive because it's a famous place. It's where Quadrophenia was filmed, other films were made there. It's well known, and people come from all over Britain to visit Madeira Drive. I mean, one of the strangest things for me was Lloyd Russell Moy's attitude at first. He was very belligerent in terms of wanting to keep Madeira Drive closed, and I give credit to him, he's a fellow Labour Party member like myself, to actually agreeing to change his mind and saying that it should be open to people.
Yeah, okay, and we're going to talk a lot more in the second half about Madeira Drive. So join us for the second half. We'll be chatting to Ollie Wilson from the campaign group and more about the campaign and more about how we rejuvenate that area of our city. So back here with Ollie Wilson from the campaign group against the pedestrianisation of Madeira Drive. It's now going to be reopened. Should we just recap on what's exactly going to happen here, Ollie? It's going to be one way, isn't it, traffic from the Brighton Palace Pier end all the way to Duke's Mound. And then there's going to be, I think, a lot bigger space for cyclists and then the pedestrians separated as well. So it's going to be kind of almost three lanes, really, for three modes of transport. Is that right?
That's correct. The council has adopted what we suggested in the campaign with the support of Councillor Lee Wares, who did a sterling job in pushing the arguments at council meetings, where it will be reopened to scooterists, mods, motorcyclists and cars where they need to access it. One way from the aquarium roundabout down to the Concord, and the seaside side of the road will be an expanded cycle lane, which will be brilliant for cyclists. I mean, many mods also cycle, and it's, you know, most of us cycle. I cycled here today. I've been cycling for 50 years. I mean, nobody wanted in this argument to do down the cyclists. It was just that it's such an important part of the town for the city, that is such an important part of the city for everybody, that we wanted facilities for everybody there.
Yeah, exactly. So everyone's happiness is in this proposal. I mean, to talk a bit more about the heritage of Madeira Drive, we should say that one of the longest green walls in the country, I think, is at the far end of Madeira Drive. So there's a lot there, isn't there, really, which people are probably unaware of. We've got the Concord 2 there still as well. We've obviously got the historic lift as well, which I think's listed. So there's a lot there. There's a lot of heritage there that people, you know, take to heart and really care about.
You only have to pick up an old postcard to look at the beautiful arches, the beautiful terraces on Madeira Drive, or pictures of the railway or the lift. The Concord has been a famous place in terms of bands who have visited over the years. There's so much heritage there. It's very important. The Green Wall, that was something that Laura and I wrote to, my partner Laura King, who started the campaign with me. We wrote to Phelan McCafferty, the council leader, about the Green Wall and made that argument. And I hope it's sunk in, because it is something that should be of importance to Greens.
Yeah.
I mean, green politics should be more about, more than just air quality, although I would dispute that having a few cars on Madeira Drive damages the air quality. You know, we should be looking at the heritage. That's very important. You know, the terraces, the Green Wall, the traditions, that should really, in my view, be all part of green politics.
Yeah, exactly. What about the future of the mods? And I know you're involved in the South Coast mods. I mean, what's the future for them now that you've got access to Madeira Drive? Is that your main kind of mecca, as it were, the main kind of focal point? Is it Madeira Drive, or
Madeira Drive is a really important place for the mods, because it's where Quadrophenia was filmed, and all of the venues down there, the Volks and the Modern World and so on, is where the mods hang out. Quadrophenia Alley is also an important part.
Yeah.
And that has restrictions, I believe, on motorised transport going down there at the moment. So that's also an issue. But it is really important, and mods do want to go there. And when it was closed, some of them were pushing their scooters through and then all the way down to get to the Volks, which is a shame when you see people who maybe not be in the first, maybe not as youthful as they once were, having to push their scooters 100 yards or so to get to the cafe. It's a real shame.
Yeah, it is, yeah. So the future of the mods, and you're getting more younger blood, aren't you, into getting involved in the mods? And I mean, it's definitely had a revival. I mean, we were saying off air about, you know, how many numbers of hits stories on the mods gets, and 34,000 on YouTube, one of our stories, you know, really colossal hits. People are really interested in the mods.
It is. It's really interesting how every decade or so you have a mod for revival. And at the moment we're seeing some teenage mods, some mods in their 20s, as well as people in their 30s, 40s, 50s, 60s and 70s. And it's kind of a golden era, really, because you have these new mods, but you also have people who are there in 64 chucking the deck chairs around. And so that generation is still around. And so it's great because everybody swaps stories and shares the tradition.
Yeah, exactly. What about the far end of Madeira Drive? That seems to have been revived, doesn't it? There'd be people doing yoga there. There's kind of more, it seems to have picked up a lot, the far end of Madeira Drive. And I know that there are proposals to kind of redevelop Black Rock at the far end as well. So there is rejuvenation going on there, but there needs to be a lot more, don't there? I mean, I know my colleague Bill Smith from Latest TV is talking about they're kind of having like a sports arena there so you can have sporting events. I mean, there's lots of ideas flying about Box Park as well. I mean, it's going to be interesting. I think the next debate really after this is probably the future, you know, what exactly we put in place there once the terraces have been restored.
Well, I think it needs to be attractive and appealing. I mean, we don't want a lot of horrible modern development. I mean, the terraces are very important, very beautiful. Stuff, development that's, sympathetic to the terraces obviously should be considered, but we don't want to have, you wouldn't want to have, I think, major fast food franchises down there. Some of the things that we've seen on the rest of the seafront, I think, would probably be very damaging to Madeira Drive.
But it's always a compromise, isn't it? Because you need people to go there to make it a destination, but at the same time trying to kind of, respect the heritage and kind of keep the terraces as they were. So it's always a difficult balancing act, isn't it? And it's going to be difficult to keep everyone happy, I think, with the future proposals.
Well, if I were running the council with their parlous financial position at the moment, I would build up the events side of it, because that's an enormous revenue source for the city and also for the city council. And so if you can have more events on Madeira Drive, make it a bigger destination. It's such a wonderful wide open space that for all sorts of events, it would be suitable.
Yep. And what are the big mod events in at Use Madeira Drive? We had a mod weekend. I mean, what's the calendar looking like for the Madeira Drive, for the use of Madeira Drive?
Well, mods tend to go there on Saturdays and Sundays.
Yeah.
And occasionally they're anniversaries relating to various mod events, such as Quadrophenia being released, all that kind of thing. The big one is, the big event is the Mod Weekender, which is in the August weekend.
Which I just saw,
The Volks, the August bank holiday, the Volks will put on mod bands, and so they become events and so on. I mean, they had some music for the Mod Weekender that was really good, but obviously as things, we've got this crisis at the moment, and we people need to fit in with what's happening to you know, not everything is viable at the moment with the government regulations. But, you know, I think that the people who ran the Mod Weekender events did a fantastic job to do it safely. I was invited to one of them, and it was brilliant the way in which it was kept completely safe, and they had a great mod band on.
Yeah, and I know that there's the big Easter egg run that the South Coast Mods run.
Absolutely.
So obviously that'll be happening next February as well.
Yeah, I mean, I'm sure that everybody wishes that we can get back to not the new normal, but the old normal as soon as possible, where we can start to do the things that we used to enjoy doing in the same way as we used to do. I mean, I don't buy into this idea that because we've had a pandemic, the pandemic will be here forever. It won't be here forever. It will be gone one day. We can return to the way that we used to live. I'm very suspicious of people trying to push their own political agendas on the back of what is really a big tragedy.
Yeah, before we go, the disabled element as well, access for disabled people to the seafront, that was a big part of the campaign, wasn't it? And that was a key part, really. You know, we shouldn't forget about people that might need proper access to the beach, via use of a vehicle.
Absolutely, and I think a lot more could be done in terms of allowing access onto the beach for disabled people with walkways and that kind of thing. I was talking with Rob Arbery, who led the disabled part of the campaign, and he was saying that, you know, there's an awful lot more you could do in terms of making the beach accessible for disabled people.
Yeah, exactly. What's the key to winning the campaign then with the local authorities? I know you're a campaigner yourself. What are the key elements to it? You've got to keep it quite simple, haven't you? Because a lot of people will be thinking, how did it happen? It's very hard to get a council or any kind of political group to change their mind, isn't it? So what do you say to those people listening that want to emulate your success?
Well, I'm not really a campaigner. This was the first thing that I've got involved in. I don't normally get involved in local politics. I support my local Labour MP, Peter Kyle, at election time, and I'm proud to do that. I got involved because I felt this was unjust. And a friend of mine who works in public affairs said that if something is so unjust that most people can see it's unjust, then you will win that campaign. And we just persisted with it, really.
Yeah.
We were reasonable.
Persistence.
We didn't do a lot of shouting or swearing. We were reasonable. We held peaceful demonstrations.
Cross-party as well.
And, the first people came on board because they quickly understood the issue were the Tories and Lee Ware. So we, you know, I'm a Labour Party member, but I worked with Lee, who was a great chap, and he helped a lot. And then gradually we started to win the argument, I think, and change Labour minds and Green minds.
Perfect. We'll leave it there. Ollie, thanks for coming. So congratulations again, and we'll catch up again soon. Thanks.
Thank you.